Our next speaker and the last speaker in this session is Dr. V.V. Binoy of the National Institute of Advanced Studies, and he will be speaking to us about animal consciousness, some fishy facts.
So, good morning. Yeah, so we were hearing the story of evolution. We started from chimpanzee, then moved to monkey, then came bird. Now we are moving to another organism, which is located in the baseline of vertebrate evolution, that is fishes. So when I said my friends that I want to check whether fish is conscious or not, first of all, the first comment came from him was, "You go and consult a psychiatrist," because we never consider fish as a living thing, rather we consider them as a vegetable or something like that. So, but the thing is that if evolution or if consciousness as a trait is there, it may have an evolutionary history also. So in this talk, I will try to analyze what are the status of the studies which focus fish consciousness in fishes as well as cognition in fishes, and we will try to know what are the two different schools popular in this area. So if you analyze the history of science itself, the consciousness studies of consciousness in animals is not that much promoted. Aristotle himself said that animals can have locomotive souls, but rational souls they can't have. And it was supported by Descartes also. And we believed that in most of the cases, they are automatons following the instincts. So usually people start the talk by defining the problem. What is animal consciousness? But I'm not going to do that. Why it is, we will know from the next slides. We are going to check why we should study animal consciousness. So first of all, the distribution question, to know which animals besides human are conscious. And if consciousness is a trait, what is the position at which it has evolved, whether it has an evolutionary continuity. And the second and most popular question, the phenomenological consciousness, what is likely to be a bat, monkey, chimpanzee, fish, insects, butterfly, it goes on. And it has very much importance also, because suffering in animals is an area which is being studied by many people. And we want to reduce that, no matter whether it is in laboratory, farms, or slaughterhouse. And there are two schools in that division of knowledge. One believes that we have to reduce the physiological stress of the animal, but at the same time, other groups believe that animals also have feelings, and that feelings are important, and psychological health and how the animal feels is to be taken care of while designing the well-being measures. But if you start to study, or if you think about studying consciousness, the biggest problem comes, the definition of consciousness. There is no universally accepted definition of consciousness. If you just check the Oxford Dictionary, you can see that 15 senses you will get for the term conscious and 10 for consciousness. And definition ranges from sleep, wakefulness, to sentience, to extended consciousness, where the organism or agent will have the capacity for language and higher level of thought. And if you go for a non-human species, there are constraints, just like the other speakers said, there is no language in which animal can say that what it is feeling. And the another problem is we use humans as benchmark species. And if you analyze the history of theories, origin of theories of consciousness, we can find that the animals are not considered while forming these theories mainly. Then extending these theories to animals often brings ambiguity. So we have to focus on the behaviors and neuroendocrinological correlates, just like Professor Somia did. So again, as far as biological analysis of consciousness is concerned, Julian Huxley was a believer that consciousness don't have any connection with behavior. He suggested that it is an epiphenomenon, like bell of a clock don't have any role in keeping the time. And he tried to prove it by removing the parts of brain of the frogs, or by giving the shock to the legs of the frog. And he proved that if it can move or it can behave, there is no need for consciousness or even brain. So was Morgan's canon. So if you analyze the history, you can see that Morgan suggested in no case we interpret an action as the outcome of exercise of a higher physical faculty if it can be interpreted as the outcome of the exercise of one which stands lower in the psychological scale. So he put a canon there and suggested that animal consciousness or animal cognition study is not that much is not that much promoted. And that affected the research on animal cognition until cognitive revolution. Then later many animal models started to come to the field. People started to check the cognitive abilities ranging from chimpanzee. So at that period it is called, some of the authors talked about that period about studying monkeys, chimpanzees, and slowly other animals also have been started to come into the field. So why should we search for consciousness? Some of the answers we have already given. So it is the lowermost strata of the vertebrate evolution. So almost all the tetrapod vertebrates evolved from some organism which resembles a fish. And more importantly, in many cases, the social cognition is connected with consciousness or evolution of consciousness. So these are the first vertebrate social system. They started a group social system called shoals, where they aggregate into group. And this is the only group which we can use to understand the evolution of creature consciousness in the animal phylogeny. And for welfare also, we need to know whether they are conscious or not. But the difficulty is with studying the fishes. Just like in the other cases, they have hands, legs, or strong beaks. Fishes don't have anything. Only fins are there. And again, another thing, no vocal communication, no expression, no gestures, which makes the scene more complicated. And more, another difficulty is they are adapted to an ecosystem which is not much familiar to us, the terrestrial human beings. And but even after that, in the last 10 to 15 years, you can see a big hike in the studies on searching for the consciousness in fishes. But many people say that the studies which follows consciousness in fishes are biased. People from the field of animals who follow animal ethics study these kind of things, and they underreport and ignore negative results. It is faith-based research or interpretation, and usually they hypothesize after the results are known, or they try to inflate the science boundary. This is another group who believes that fishes cannot be conscious. We will discuss all that in coming slides. But at the same time, Eucotic has an opinion that fishes are the victim of speciesism because they don't resemble us at any level, and they are far behind us in the evolution. So we cannot believe that fishes can have consciousness. But you should see, the first comprehensive review of cognition and learning in fish came in 1990 only. So it's a very young branch of science, and without having enough evidence, we cannot say that whether fish is conscious or not. Okay, let's go through the literature and we will share some of our work also. So the first thing is that these are the major things said about the evidences against fish cannot be conscious, because there is a strong belief that fish cannot have long-term memory. And there is a famous saying called 3-second memory, you may know, and which was been propagated by the Dory in that film Finding Nemo, who forgets everything. And people found that they have very small brain. If you go for a largemouth shark, which grows up to 1000 kilograms, it has a brain of around 20 to 30 grams only. So very small brain to body ratios. And Professor Matsava's case, or Professor Nandia's case, or Professor Samia's case, the animal has an evolved neopallium. Fishes don't have that also. So it's a primitive brain, no neocortex, no amygdala, no hippocampus, no dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And one more thing came, the full-fledged consciousness people expected in amniotes only, because it requires a lot of investment of energy in the brain, maintenance of brain. So Kabnak and Kabnak suggested that cold-blooded animals cannot be conscious. And more importantly, there is no REM sleep in fishes, and no stress-induced fever, cannot experience hedonic states like pain or pressure. So this was the situation when the subject started, or just like in the beginning of the fish cognition, or before 1990. And this is the space at which Kabnak suggested that the consciousness has emerged. So they suggested that the sign of conscious thing is, there should be emotion, There should be sensory pleasures, there should be play, there should be sleep. In fishes, it is not. All these things are not. And you can see the fish brain also. It is mainly the optical tectum and the telencephalon is there, but it is not like a mammal brain or bird brain. But what happened that the scenario changed when people started to explore the fishes? This was just beliefs in the beginning. So let us check the first thing required for a conscious organism: sleep and wakefulness. It is believed that it is to be the organism has to be, or the agent has to be awake to be aware. So that is the first step in the beginning in the consciousness. So people studied fish sleep or the rest. We put it in cotton comma, in inverted comma, because this is not resembling human sleep where we close our eyes, because fishes don't have eyelid, and they go to a place and they rest there. And what you can see that they will change their color. In our species, the species which we focus, they become more dark, and if you irritate, they won't move away from that place. So they found that the drugs that can alter mammalian sleep system is also working in fishes. You can give sleeping pills to fishes. And another thing is that the Hippocratic orexin system, which promote wakefulness in animals, other animals like mammals or human beings, that is also found in fishes. And another interesting characteristic was the sleep rebound. That was also reported in zebra fish. We don't know what is happening in other species of fishes. And to be aware, if you analyze the consciousness, it starts, one of the primary level at which it starts is conscious cognition. It's called sentience. Called sentience also. So in this condition, the animal should be, or the agent should be able to aware of internal and external stimulus. And if when the animal or the agent became able to aware of the internal and external stimulus, in the next level of consciousness, that is primary consciousness or anoetic consciousness, which is commonly called in consciousness literature, starts. It can generate a mental scene in which diverse information could be integrated for the purpose of directing behavior. And this kind of mental representation, just like in the case of an organism, it could be just a procedural representation. One stimulus, one response. So even the machine do that. But if it is a declarative representation, it permits selective attention to internal and external stimulus and allowing flexibility of behavior and adaptive responses. The animal is able to, or the agent is able to selectively focus on something and draw it and mix it to divert its behavior. This concept is often associated with another concept called proto-self. This is the primitive form of coherence of world and self-representation. So in order to become conscious, or at least primitive conscious, the organism has to integrate the information from self as well as the integration from the world. And it's a template for fundamental intrinsic aspect of self. Again, since we are analyzing fish, in quote unquote, self. So let us see whether fishes can develop spatial representation. It was tested in 1951 itself. The species was Bathygobius soporatus. So what they did that, they made a pool in which the goby was kept, and they gave two other pools where water level was different. And they mimicked the low tide situation. And they found that gobies always jumped the area or the pools where the more water is available. So they make a representation of their external world, as well as they know that I have to jump there. So the recent study shows that it analyzes utilization of spatial information in fishes is increasing, and they show that they can learn and they can change the spatial map or the cognitive map of the routes they learn. So we try to do another thing using our model system climbing first. We try to test another thing, that is decision making. So in decision making, animal has to evaluate two cues. And according to the value available, it has to change, it take a decision or reach a decision. So this is our fish. So this is a simple apparatus which we used in our studies. And we tested that. Usually, we believe that fishes follow instincts. So we want to know whether the instincts will be affected by the other cues. If the animal is able to integrate that information, it will be able to integrate that information and the instinct can be modified. So we tested in fishes, it's a standard test. You can give a large shoal and a small shoal, and they usually join large shoal because it provides more benefit. So we found that there is an instinct towards large shoal. Then what we did that we brought in the familiarity with the fishes, the other members. So one side there will be a group, other side there will be a group, because as far as stimulus size and stimulus intensity are concerned, they are equal, but one is familiar. And we found that they go for familiar fishes. And we even tried for the trade-off to know whether familiarity can be, that is, their acquired cognitive characteristics can trade off with the instinct that is going for a large group. And we found that that works only when the confusion comes. But the story became very interesting when we tried to test it in another context of a context where we tried to test whether the fish has the capacity to use the familiarity in while taking a decision of a heterospecific, some other species or some species from other, some individual from other species. So the result was interesting. After developing familiarity for 120 days, climbing birds never went for response species. So questioning the gene selection, so what it did that, it preferred the familiar group of tilapia, which is an unknown, which is a heterospecific fish, which it has seen for the first time in its life, and it never went and joined the group of its own species. So the instincts can be modified. So we tested whether they are able to recognize the individuals, and we found that due to individual recognition is limited to their own species. So they are able to recognize the individual just like I can recognize you if they belong to the climbing birds. If other species, even though they develop familiarity, they are not able to do that. So there are limitations for the capacities. So what another interesting study they did, that is from Grosselick group, what they did that they tried to know whether the fish has the capacity for transitive inference. So you may know that if we don't have to test everything, if you are able to see two people interacting and the first person interacting with another person, you'll be able to come up with a sequence in your brain. So Grosselick et al, what they did that, they tried to understand the interaction pattern or the fighting pattern between the members of Astatotilapia bertoni, another kind of fish. So usually what happens that the dominant fish, when a submissive fish meets a dominant fish, usually they darken their body color to show that, to acknowledge that this is the superior nature of the other fish. So here what they did that they tried to have a dyad between A and B and C and D and D and E, and they tried and one fish was allowed to observe this dyad. And they found that this fish was able to position itself in that line. It arranged the group according to the fighting ability, and it only fought with the members which is below its fighting ability in that line. So as far as cognition is concerned, the capacity for monotonicity, arrangement of the value the, or something according to the values, is one amongst the very important trait that you can see here. So this is another famous example published by Milinski, tit for tat, you may know that. So in these two animals, what they found that they recognize the other individuals, and they are able to attribute the value to the other individuals, and a proto-trust kind of behavior develops here. So in stickleback, what they do that when they go to examine a predator, they go in pairs. So if one of the member is a cheater means in between it will run away from that, usually the fish will not go for the predator inspection with that fish. And a similar thing has been seen in egg trading Black Hamlet. This fish, what it do that, this is a hermaphroditic fish which produces both egg and sperm, and they gather at one place, and one fish will provide some egg to the other fish, and that fish will inseminate the eggs. Then this fish has to return their egg to the other fish, and this fish will inseminate that. So there are cheaters again. They won't give the egg back. They will get the egg from the other fish, they will inseminate it, and they will run away. So the fishes will they will remember that fish, and they won't go for any egg trade with that fish. So they call it the Milinski's nature paper come with the title tit for tat. That's also seen in fishes. And another capacity called Machiavellian intelligence, which is considered to be the capacity for which requires a higher brain centers, that's also been reported from fishes. This is the fish is cleaner ras, the small fish you can see which is sitting inside the mouth of a moray eel. So this fish is a beautician of the ocean, and it cleans the teeth and body of the other fishes. You can see there are two rasas cleaning the fishes. So here what they do that, usually while cleaning, just like you know when you go to the beauty parlor, especially ladies know, when the beautician plucks the eyebrow, sometimes it will be hurting. So what they do that if the other fish shows such behaviors that hurt, they will do the reconciliation behavior by touching on the face. And another interesting thing is that if they will do that. So what happens sometimes, you know, this behavior if it continues and they have another habit, they will eat the mucosa, buccal mucosa from the host, sometimes the host will chase them. So in that case, what they will do, they will start to lose the clients. So in ocean, what happens that usually fish comes to the cleaner ras and they will be waiting for the service of cleaner ras. So this bad beautician is going to lose the clients. So what they will do that, they will have resident clients who regularly visit them. They will go there and they will try to show that their image, they are a very good cleaner, and they will try to enhance the image. Yeah, so that's called image scoring. So they will try to show by touching the known fishes, and the others may be going. And if the interesting thing is that if a new fish comes there, it will increase the reconciliation behavior shown to the other fishes. So if you analyze whether they have the machinery to do that, you can see that the brain center is required for social behavior as well as for reward system is, or to make a social decision making, it is present in fishes. You can see all the areas homologous to the mammalian brain in fishes also. So the ultimate thing comes, mirror test. Usually fish don't get a chance to see its reflections, because just like Professor Sapia said, birds can see in the water, because fish is living in the water, it can't see its reflection. So but the ultimate test is mirror test, whether the fish has a self or not. So the study shows that if you show a mirror to the fish, this is just like in the case of bird, they will show aggressive behavior. But earlier people believed that this is treating like the fish is treating the other fish like a conscious fish trying to intrude its area. But a recent paper which came in 2014, they found that they analyzed the brain variation or the C4 expression, that is the immediate gene, as well as the production of 11-beta testosterone. And testosterone and the cortisol in the brain, in the body of the fish, when they see a mirror image and a real conscious thing, and they found that there is variation. It may not be the self-recognition, but there do exist some variation in treating mirror image as well as the real conscious thing. So this is another thing. So self always goes to self-control. We never expect that fish will be able to do the self-control, because it is very difficult even for a primate to do a self-control. So people, the group, Dan Eastman and the group, they try to analyze a paradigm called reverse reward contingency test. Here what they will do that, in two chambers, they gave, in one chamber it is a small reward, that is small amount of food. In the large chamber it is large amount, in the other chamber it is large amount of food. So usually fish will select large food, just like in the case of our case. But that fish will not be available, will be allowed to feed that large food. Instead, they will change the food tray in such a way that if they choose the large food, large amount of food over the small amount of food, it will get small amount of food only. So fish has to learn in such a way that it has to learn in a reverse way, that if I choose a small thing, I may get a large thing, just like the people say. So initially they never expected that fish will be able to do that, but later they found that out of the 9 cleaner ras they tested, one of them was able to do that. It was a female fish. Whenever this decision making thing comes, it follows that reverse reward contingency test. So we tested the reaction towards mirror in clienting person, and we found that if you give a mirror, the lateralized utilization of brain, fish has a peculiarity, its body is laterally compressed and there is no isolateral connection towards the cerebral hemispheres. So if the fish has to use its left hemisphere, it has to turn rightwards. Means right eye directly connect to the leftwards. So it is easy to study the lateralization in fishes, because you can do it by observation itself. So what we found was that you can see the eye use pattern towards unfamiliar, familiar, conspecific, heterospecific and mirror image. And mirror image, the lateral utilization is different. We have the data of around 120 fishes. So the pattern of mirror lateralized utilization towards mirror is also different in fishes. So study shows that, another thing, whether fish can have emotional fever. Just like all of us, if we go through a traumatic condition or a stressful condition, we feel fever. So people tried, very recently it was published, if you keep fishes in stressful condition, they also develop a situation which could be comparable to the emotional fever. They always go for the area of the water body with warmer water. And they can be addicted to drugs. And there is a famous paper from Gelray with the title, Drink Like a Fish. And they have used zebrafish as a model system. And another interesting thing, in connection with the Parkinson's disease or the mesolimbic dopamine system, MPTP is usually given to induce the Parkinson's disease in mammals like rats. If you give it to goldfish, it will develop similar conditions. And Derek says that the ocular abnormalities that are common in Parkinson's syndrome can also induce in fishes by altering dopaminergic neurotransmitters. So you can see the neural correlates for the capacities which an organism with amygdala and hippocampus shows, like lateral and medial pari of telencephalons are functionally homologous to hippocampus and amygdala. And like other vertebrates, telencephalon also receives projections from thalamus. And there is a reward system. And there is a comparison between teleost, lateral, the parium and median parium with human amygdala and hippocampus. You can see most of the things, there is homology. And this is the distribution of dopaminergic and serotonergic system in fishes. And this is the most controversial topic in fish research, pain, because pain requires subjective experience. So there are studies which shows that fish can feel pain, but other groups says that there is very less C5 birds, which is common in mammals, which transmits pain, and alpha-delta fibers are very common in fishes. Some others believe that this is the problem of definition, because International Association for Pain Research, they consider pain should be there even if there is no stimulus at all. Certain cases people can feel pain if there is no stimulus at all. But still, this contradiction or the research in both fields goes on. And when we focus on telencephalon and its equivalence to mammalian behavior, Overmeer and Hollis in 1993 did an experiment. What they did that they separated cerebral hemisphere from the fishes. They removed it. And they left only the diencephalon and brainstem and spinal cord. And they tested it in many species and they found that the fish still keep the capacity for consuming the food, sensory discrimination, social behaviors, including schooling, spawning, intra-species aggression, etc. But there is no studies where they are able to do it, take a decision in that case. And they use it as a evidence against fish that cannot could be automaton, like our Huxley's frog, which don't have the brain but shows the behavior. And two slides I forgot to add, or that I didn't add, so I thought that there won't be time. Fish can use tools. There are studies which shows that you may know that archer fish, which throws water into the water to get, just like an archer uses his arrow, it uses water to get the prey sitting outside for the water body. And there are studies, Timmerman study shows that if the experimenter or somebody goes there to disturb it, they will use the same tool they will throw water into the eyes of the people who is coming to disturb them. So they are using that tool. And there is another gestural result for gestural communication, or the communication between two species are also available in fishes now. It is a pugilistic hunting between moray eel and gropus. These gropus go there and signal the moray eels the prey is there, just like honey-guided bird. And it don't do to any other predator. So the problem with fish consciousness or cognition is that we have 32,000 species. So you're calling it fish and saying that this animal don't have any capacity to do that or do this. We cannot say that because there are 32,000 species. And each species are adapted to different environment. You can see fishes which is living in underground waters, no ice. And you can see sharks or something like that which is living in different kind of ecosystem. And you may have a goldfish which is living in your in your aquarium. All of them requires different kind of adaptations. So some others suggested, so the studies, if you conclude, we can see that they may have primary consciousness and a proto-self, and maybe experience to, they may be experiencing the mental states that are qualitatively different from human beings, because they are aquatic organism adapted to some other things. And this awareness could be graded, because they are living in different kind of ecosystems, varying the pressure, the selection pressure they have to, varying the selection pressure. So that much is there about fish and the fishy facts. Thank you very much.